else do we have here? Tim Hawkins, don't forget, we got Tim Hawkins coming up April 27th. We still have tickets available for the matinee event. And to give you another glimpse at some of his material, I've got a video for you this morning, so let's go ahead and play that Tim Hawkins clip, please.
But it's true. I mean, I got three boys and a girl. Boys and girls are totally different. My boys are just violent. Girls are just dance everywhere. Make a bowl of cereal. They're adorable. Boys are violent, man. Even when a boy likes a girl, he's violent. You ever see a little boy at a public pool? He likes a girl, he's like dunking her under. Sticking her head in the filter. Oh, yeah. You are the one for me, sweetie. You ever see a little boy smitten with a girl? It's hilarious. He's like, look at her. She's amazing. I must have her in my life. She is my day. She is my night. She is my flower. I must prove my love for her, to have her forever. So with all my heart and with all my soul and with all my might, I shall throw this rock at her. And as the blood trickles down her temple, she will know the depths of my affection. If she survives, we will be wed. Go. Find your mark, little pebble. Find your mark.
All right, funny stuff. So you can get your tickets at timhawkins.net. Like I said, we still have tickets available for the afternoon matinee, which is 3 o'clock on that Sunday, the 27th. 7 p.m. is the evening show. Also, lastly, Legacy Journey. We're going to be starting that here in a couple weeks. Wednesday, April 9th is our first Wednesday class. Sunday morning, that following Sunday, the 13th, will be our Sunday morning class. Really need you to get signed up today so we can get things in order for that, get our materials ordered. You have an insert in your bulletin, so you can reference that for details. All right, we're going to take just about a minute and a half here, greet some people that have just come in. Don't get too far and wide because we've got a baby dedication we want to do, so why don't you greet each other for a moment or so. Thank you.
my good morning as well. Thank you for slip sliding along here. No snow days at church. You can't ever make up a snow day at church. If you miss it, you never know what you'll miss. Before we gather our those who are bringing a Matthew in dedication today, let me just mention a couple of things to you. And Sam and the ushers, I'll have you ready because we're going to facilitate these sign-up clipboards. But I want to be real clear. How many weeks are we out from Easter? Like 3, correct? And Easter weekend is always a wonderful celebration here. Number one, on Friday evening, we have traditionally what we call Good Friday Night Worship. And boy, you ought to come. You ought to be inviting people to come to that. Just a wonderful time on Good Friday to think about God's great love is extended through Jesus on the cross. And that's really the focus. And then Easter Sunday morning is always a great celebration. Now, be reminded that on Easter Sunday morning, is everybody with me? Repeat after me. We have 2 services, not yet. Our 2 service times are 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock. That's in the a.m. All right? And Easter is still probably the number one day when people will consider going to church. You ought to be inviting family, friend, foe, whatever, okay? Sunday morning is always great. And I hope some of you will do your best to balance it. For some of you, it'll work to come at 11, for others at 9. But there's no way we could house everybody in one service. So just know that coming up. On that special day, we always have special needs with our kids, especially our preschool kids. And last year, we did something that was so helpful. And we're going to do it again because Gail and her crew, Miss Gail, right here, wave your hand. She is always so appreciative of help from the adult department, and especially because of having 2 services. So on these clipboards coming around with the blue sheet, it's divided into 3 sections. If you can help possibly one of the services or during Good Friday Night of Worship, would you please sign appropriately, okay? And we're going to send these to every section, so the ushers will do that. And again, just help us out. We have a lot of kids that day that have to be lovingly cared for, and that calls for an extra amount of love on our part. So let's pass those out. If you can help in one of those 3 times, Friday night or either service on Easter Sunday, 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock, that would be so helpful. And I know Gail is eternally grateful. She's a happy person with that. So we've got them going all through the grandstand as well. They're going there. All right. What's that? Did you want to say something, Kathy?
I just wanted to chime in because Gail and I were talking about that this week. You can help one service and attend the other.
Exactly.
You're not going to miss anything.
Yeah, because a lot of times people go, I can't help because we only are doing one service right now. But on that day, no excuse.
Right.
No excuse. Right?
Right.
Very good. Thank you, Kathy.
I'll be up here both services, though.
All right. Okay. Hey, another thing, too, just let me say that we're so blessed to have so many volunteers serving. And from Sunday to Sunday, I hope it is never a distraction, but it's always a blessing when you just see the ushers moving around during service, caring for people. That's a part of the fixture, right? And we also have an unbelievable volunteer security team, what we're calling safety team. It's preventative. And sometimes they're dealing with stuff you may not know, but we have the finest of the finest. And when you see them moving, just thank the Lord for them providing safety for us all. So aren't we thankful for those people that labor in that way, a labor of love? So when we have people moving around and just, you know, when things happen from time to time in a crowd and we don't go, oh, it's so horrible. No, I mean, when we have church, we should have all kinds of people, broken people here. And that's not a bad thing. How do you know that's good? So a part of our thing is just we have people moving around and never get alarmed. Just be thankful for it and say, man, they're on the ball and helping provide safety here. Preventatively, especially for all. So thanks to those of you who labor in those ways, watching our kids, helping out, behind-the-scenes tech, all of those things coming up. One other thing I wanted to mention, in a couple of weeks, we're going to start doing some foyer ministry fairs, and we're going to highlight various ministries, and worship ministries is going to go first in a couple of weeks on the 13th, and we're going to have different tables spread out there so you can see the needs and be aware of them and say, you know, here's where we really need help, because we're trying to get enough help with all these things so that nobody's burned out doing it week after week after week. So just be aware of that, and so many opportunities. I told the staff and board that more and more, our next membership classes, I'm going to tell people, around, if you want to join this church, do not join unless you're going to find a place to serve. You know, we don't need just more spectators to come see. That's great for guests. But when you choose to unite with this church, you need to have a place, at least a place, where you're going to minister faithfully and say, you can count on me. I love it when I hear people say they move from this is your church or that church to my church, our church. And that means that we serve and we give. All right. Let's have those come who are coming for Josh and Danielle. Let's bring Matthew, and let's offer him to the Lord in Christian dedication. My wife Dixie is joining me, as well as Gail, who's our director of our preschool ministries, and we're so thankful for her. And whenever you see Gail, think of the masses that she represents, not only kids, but volunteers. And I don't know how many volunteers you have on a given, I mean, not just a Sunday, but through the year. A lot. They come and go, and she does that too, that rotation thing, which really helps. Yeah, feel free to go wherever you want for pictures. Everybody gather real close. Mom and Dad are right here, and just gather in real close. Yeah. Anybody else want to come up and join us? I love it. All right. Are moms and dads close, family? Moms and dads, come over this way closer, okay? Get close. Get close. And grandparents, get close. Get close. Yeah, get close. All right. The life verse that we often go by is from Proverbs 22:6, and I'll just use the Message paraphrase of it today. It talks about it this way. As parents, and it's really about you guys today, far more than about him. It is. And here's the word of the Lord to you. Point your child. I'll just say, point Matthew in the right direction. And when he is old, he won't be lost. God has created Matthew to be a worshiper. And the only way his life is going to truly be fulfilled is to become that. To build his life on a foundation of God and his goodness and faithfulness. So, Mom and Dad, you're here. Matthew didn't have a choice. He just had to come along. But you're here intentionally. And I challenge you each day to be reminded that you are making deposits in his life. Deposits of love. Deposits in the memory that he will cherish as he gets older. So make those deposits very well. So I would say again that baby dedications are far more about parents than children. Children will never remember this day, and parents will never forget it. Never forget, because you know that you're standing before God and man, offering him back to the Lord. And so I remind you that the key to the unfolding days and years is for you guys to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love each other. Nothing will give him more security than that, I promise you. As the years come and go with consistency. And we know that it's your heart desire in every way you can to bless Matthew. Here's some wonderful words from Proverbs 4. It's talking about, really unspoken, about how important parents are. Because the writer says they're so important, children, that listen when your father corrects you. Pay attention and learn good judgment, for I am giving you good guidance. Don't turn away from my instructions. For I too, the writer speaks, was once my father's son, tenderly loved as my mother's only child. My father taught me, take my words to heart, follow my commands, and you will live. So the challenge here is to speak continually over and into Matthew's life Because when you do it regularly, day in, day out, whether you realize it or not, it's having a huge impact. You have the power of blessing when you remember to think thoughts and speak words that bless and encourage and strengthen along the way. And so in this passage, we see that you're to speak with words of wisdom, divinely inspired words of life. You're to speak with words that would lengthen their life, give a long life, and with words that lead them in a straight path, with words in Proverbs 6:21 that impact and change the heart. Words that will guide them as they walk, that will watch over them as they sleep, and speak to them when they are awake. And mom and dad, I pray that in order to do that effectively, that you'll hide God's word in your heart so that you will be able to speak from the wellspring of his word. My pastor used to say, I'm so glad that God has given parents to children because they desperately need them so much. And he's given parents, mom and dad, the wonderful opportunity for lasting positive influence of blessing through your thoughts and attitudes and words and actions every day. He has entrusted him to your tender care, and he's given you his book to guide you in this daily adventure. So I'm here to proclaim today in 2014 that God still really believes in parents. He believes in godly parents. Godly parents bring a smile to his face and to his heart. I believe that's true. So love him, love each other, and love them. Love him, love each other, and love them. Well, I know that you believe these truths in your heart. So before God and these witnesses, those you love and are close to, and these seated here, with God's help, giving and living your lives before him daily, with his assistance, will you do your best to guide Matthew in the ways of God and to be a blessing to him so that he can be raised to be the worshiper that God has intended for him to be? If so, would you answer? We will. Family and friends, so glad to have you here. Baby dedications are precious, especially when we're connected to them, heart to heart. I'm so thankful, and I don't know how far and wide you are, all are, but I love it when we can be in proximity and be together regularly, and you all have influence. And so if you will use your influence, whatever God gives you towards godliness, to the best of your ability, would you answer, we will. And congregation, we have a room in our heart for yet another little one to model Jesus and his love in this place. If so, would we answer? We will. All right. We'll do the life verse that they've chosen at the end here. I'll take this little guy. He's sleeping, right? I'm glad he didn't. Well, he was. Aw, see those little lips puckering like that? All right. Matthew, Ezra, it's my privilege as your pastor to give you back to God, because you're a blessing from him. And in so doing, we dedicate you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, I thank you for this precious life filled with promise. You alone know his days and time, the length of his life. But you have hope and you have plans and a purpose for him. And so we pray a blessing over him today in this dedication, something that his parents have done and will do continually as time passes. May your protection and love and grace be over him to guard his ways physically, emotionally, and spiritually. And may he grow up to be all that you've called and destined your heart for him to be, a worshiper of the one true, the only living God. Bless mom and dad, and may they take their influence seriously. Nobody loves them more than mom and dad do, besides you, Father. And may their heart be filled and lives be filled with wisdom that comes from your spirit and from your word. So we give him back to you, with hearts full of praise and thanksgiving. And we add this blessing as well.
Matthew, your name means gift of God. And Ezra means helper. So those are fun names that you have chosen for him. I love that. So I was looking through God's word, and I came across the Beatitudes. And I read it in the message, and something just stirred in me. So I'm going to read the Beatitudes from the message today. Matthew, you are blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God and his rule. You are blessed when you feel you lost what is most dear to you. Only then can you be embraced by the one most dear to you. You are blessed when you're content with just who you are, no more, no less. That's the moment you find yourself proud owner of everything that cannot be bought. Matthew, you are blessed when you've worked up a good appetite for God. He's food and drink and the best meal you'll ever eat. You are blessed when you care. At the moment of being careful or full of care, you find yourself cared for. You are blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. Matthew, you are blessed when your commitment to God provokes persecution. The persecution drives you even deeper into God's kingdom. Not only that, count yourself blessed every time people put you down or throw you out or speak lies about you to discredit me. What it means is that the truth is too close for comfort and they are uncomfortable. You can be glad when this happens. Give a cheer even, for though they don't like it, I do, and all heaven applauds. Be blessed, Matthew.
All right. And offer the mic to his father so he can give the gist of the life verse. Okay.
The life verse we picked for Matthew comes from Luke 1:37, when Gabriel was telling Mary that she was going to give birth to Jesus. And Gabriel said, with God, all things are possible.
Very good. All right. How about a little kiss from Grandma here? Yeah. How about a little kiss to Miss Gail? Could we congratulate them on a job well done? Thanks for being here today so much.
As pastor's greeting them, I want to make a quick introduction. Tim and Stephanie Christ, where are you guys at? Way up there. You got the little one with you, Araya? Can we get a camera? Larissa, maybe swing it around, or I don't know if Lane, you can get your camera around to get a shot of them up there in the grandstand. Their little one, Araya Brienne, she'll be 4 weeks old on Tuesday, and just want to get her up on screen so you can see her, and we can congratulate them on their little one. Can we get a shot by any chance? That's a tough camera angle. Tough camera angle, but make sure and greet them and see their little one. Congratulations, guys.
Thank you, Joel. Well, the ushers take their places, please, and let's pray as we begin this music portion of our worship today. Come right ahead and you can stand in your places. As we pray. Father, we thank you for this good and wonderful day. No complaints here. You have been, you are always good. And we're here to celebrate your greatness. We never want to miss an occasion to gather in this way and to stream our worship live together, life upon life. I pray as we worship you in song, through returning and giving whatever the means may be today, that our hearts will be filled, overwhelmed with your great love, with gratitude for who you are and what you have done in our lives. May everyone from the youngest to the oldest in the room truly enter in and offer the best of who we are back to you today, which is the least that we can do. May our hearts be receptive to your word as we talk about worship and gratitude being the posture of our lives, and may it be true. And maybe have things that we plug our lives into as we go away this day. May the truth of your word stay alive and vibrant deep within us, I pray. So again, we thank you for the gift of this day and the privilege we have to sing songs that others have written to you and about you, and sing songs that have been written in this house to you and about you to make your name glorious. And what a privilege it is to invest in your kingdom that never ends. And I pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Here we go. Nate's back from vacation. Gatlinburg, Kathy, great job last week with all of your help and with all of your team as well. And Kayla, too, by the way, and family. All right. You can be in whatever posture. Maybe it'd be good for us to begin by standing if you can. And then when you, as I always say, when you run out of stand, don't run out of worship, okay? But let's make a joyful noise to the Lord. Here we go, all the people.
We sing. Nothing is impossible for you. You're my portion. I believe. your name is praised. You are worthy of all praise. We lift up your name is praised. 'Cause you are worthy of all praise. We lift up your
our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above.
exclaim, our God is mighty. Sing.
And we exclaim.
Worship service as a part of the worship aspect is because in coming to the table, it always reminds us of who He is and what He has done. And then that gives us perspective in who we are and whose we are. Amen. You know what? Something I want us to do corporately. We haven't done a lot publicly about it, but Pastor Joel is having surgery. Major surgery on Friday in the afternoon. And I want there just to be a mighty roar of praise lifted from this body on his behalf and his precious family. We love Joel, don't we, and his family? And so right now, I don't know what your, I don't know how comfortable you are, but I just want to do that. I'm going to lead in prayer. And if you're not, just, I want you to pray out loud where you are, if it's okay, okay? If do it audibly, whisper, whatever. But I just want to lift a mighty roar of prayer and praise and thanksgiving to God and His faithfulness right now. Could we do that? Everybody in the grandstand, let's all just do that right now. Father in heaven, You are absolutely in control. And we have been focusing on Your greatness, Your name, and who You are. We believe what we've been singing about. Our God is an awesome God. You are in control. You stand above and through all things. You work in and through everything. We have sung this morning that nothing is impossible for You, and we know that's true. Absolutely. We believe that You're our healer. We believe that all those things come to us through our lives. So, Lord Jesus, Joel is Your child today. How we love him and how we thank You for the gift that he is ministering to us and faithfully over these years. And thank You what You've done in his life and Lisa's life and their kids and their family. And we pray a blessing over him right now. And Lord, we ask for Your healing touch to be upon him in any and every way that You choose. However, through this procedure, anybody who comes near him, may they be under Your anointing and Your power and Your touch, oh God. And we ask that You would raise him up to complete and utter absolute wholeness and healing, oh God. And Lord, as this procedure unfolds on Friday afternoon, if that's your will, Lord, we lift them to you collectively. We do it right now, but there's going to be a mighty roar of prayer arising from your people who have confidence in the God you are, the God we've been singing about, the God we've been singing to today. So I pray that you would get glory through all of this, Father. I thank you for the peace and grace that he has been standing in, and we pray for an abundance of your blessing and your touch upon him. Thank you in advance, Lord, for how you're going to give him a new platform, even through this season that he has gone through, that he is going to proclaim your name in even greater ways. So may your peace, the peace that passes all understanding, guard his heart in Christ Jesus. And as I pray for him, I pray for Lisa, I pray for his kids, I pray for his parents, and their family, and for all of in this house. And we proclaim your greatness, that every ounce of healing comes to the God who you are, and that you are great. We magnify your name, and we pray it collectively and positively and expectantly in the life-giving, healing name of Jesus. And everybody in the house said, amen. Amen. We stand in awe of Almighty God. We stand in awe of Almighty God. He's your child. Bless your heart. Well, we're going to continue to focus on the awesomeness of God for just a couple of moments. It's our privilege to share joys and burdens together. But I just want to touch on a couple things because we've talking today about worship and gratitude. Go ahead, you're fine. And I just want to remind you that God has created us all. He's designed us all to be worshipers. That's our lifetime. That's our eternal calling that begins right now. So we've got to keep going in that. We've got to keep growing in that worship of the living God. Nobody will be forced to fulfill this calling, this high calling. It's about our free will being engaged. Genuine worship can only flow from our hearts when it's been prepared, our heart that overflows with gratitude for him. Don't you have a sense that that's what we've been standing in this morning? Gratitude for who God is? You see, everything else hinges on gratitude, who God is. If we don't get that straight, our worship is going to get in the deep weeds. It's going to be anemic and ineffective. But it starts by focusing on the greatness of God. I said before, I think it was Tozer who wrote in so many words, he said that if there's a problem with our worship, that if it's weak or small or it's not so great, it's because we've reduced God and he's not the great God. I mean, he is, but we've reduced him to our own standard and understanding. He says so much is determined in life by our God view. So much is determined by our God view. So I just ask you, what's your view of God today? That shapes your destiny. That shapes your life. Is your God truly an awesome God that we've been singing about? Job 25, 1 and 2 says it. God is powerful. All must stand in awe of him. Got that? Job 25, God is powerful. It doesn't say he was, it says he is. All must stand in awe of him. How many of you know that includes us today? Wouldn't you agree that the word awesome has been overused and undervalued in our culture? Everything's awesome. I'm not so sure about that. Our culture says so, but we must determine, hear me, never to stand in awe of a mere mortal man or woman, because the Bible tells us that all is reserved for God and God alone. We don't worship anybody created in God's form, human or non-human. We worship the one creator. It is true to say of him, he is an awesome God. But that glory is due to him alone. Psalm 88:7 says it so clearly as well. Even, in other words, the highest angelic powers with great power, they stand in awe of God. He is far more awesome than all those who surround his throne. Read in Revelation about those, the power and greatness of those who surround his throne. And the angels say, God is greater than all of us collectively put together. He is powerful. We don't worship those heavenly beings. We do not. Michael and Gabriel are just small reflections, even in their greatness, of how great God is and how glorious he is. They're small reflections that point us towards him. They represent God to man. God's character, his attributes, who he is and always will be, reveal his heart to all of us. We cannot fathom the depths of who he is, but we can grasp enough of his greatness to keep us bowing before him and worshiping him for a lifetime. Would you agree? I mean, there's more of us to know and to realize and understand, but we know enough. And there's two things, basically, I want to tell you about this awesome God. And I hope we just crash that word awesome out of our vocabulary. I mean, I know it's not as popular as it used to be. That's because we wore it out. But how many of you know that awesome is still good when it comes to God? Let's just make sure that we say awesome stands for God alone. Two things that I want to remind you of in his greatness today in these closing minutes. Two things. And I just to give us a word of his greatness, his infiniteness, I want to say, first of all, in that awesomeness that he is, first of all, universally awesome, okay? That means in all, through all, over all, above all, you name it all, he is all in all. He is universally awesome. Who is? God. Not our favorite singer or star or anybody else. God alone stands as universally awesome, this great God that he is. We talked in depth about his infiniteness. Psalm 92 speaks of it when it says that the mountains were born before you gave birth to the earth and the world from the beginning to the end. It says, you are God. Don't you love that phrase? It doesn't say you will be God or you were God. It says present tense active, you are God. And that's enough for you and yours and us and all of us right where we stand. He alone is God. He is awesome. The greatness of God right here, right now, always is. God refers to himself not as the great I was, but the great I am, right now and always. No last number, never ending, outside of the human realm, never running out, no having no end, existing forever, unbound, timeless, priceless, never growing weary, no sleep required, no aging process, never upgraded, self-sufficient, self-contained. God has no needs. He is uncontainable. That's a good word for God that we ought to write a song about, uncontainable. Wow. God doesn't need a thing. He doesn't need our worship, but he desires it. Worshiping is a great gift to us, the privilege and the responsibility of giving our praise to him. We benefit from it, but if we choose to direct our worship away from him because we're all worshipers, he's still God. He's still I am. That doesn't add anything to his greatness. It doesn't subtract it. But I want you to know that when we stand in awe of him with our lips and with our lives, he gains great pleasure. Is there anything greater in our life than we could do than give pleasure to the one who created all the wonders and all the stars and all the heavens? You know why he did that? Because you find when it's talking about worship, there's always this phrase, look up, look up, look up. That's why so much is about the heavens, because we never look down. The Bible doesn't say to look within, it says to look up. Look up, our salvation draws near. Look up, our help comes from the Lord who made all that is. That's the posture. So I think we just ought to read this scripture out loud together. Do you have it, Romans 11 up there? 11:33. Come on, let's just thunderously read this out loud together, okay? Here we go. Oh, what a wonderful God we have. How great are his riches and wisdom and knowledge. How impossible it is for us to understand his decisions and methods. For who can know what the Lord is thinking? Who knows enough to be his counselor? And who could ever give him so much that he would have to pay it back? One more verse, no? Are we out of verse? 36 says, for everything comes from him, everything exists by his power and is intended for his glory. To him be glory forevermore. And the last word says amen, so let's all say it. Amen. Amen. Exclamation point. Positive. I jotted down in my margin, does not the highest creativity of man extol the greater creative genius of God? I mean, the best thing, the most creative, the best thing that man could ever produce, doesn't that extol the creative, even greater creative genius of God Almighty? Nothing is impossible for him. Isaiah 40, 26 says it. Look up. There's that word. Look up. Look up. You got to go through your Bible, the word search, and circle how many times it says look up into the heavens. Who created all the stars? He brings them out like an army, one after another, calling each by name. Because of his great power and incomparable strength, not a single one is missing. Genesis 1:1 starts it off with this irrefutable fact. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Everything. Everything. For since the world has begun, Romans 1:20 says, was created. People have seen the earth and the sky. Through everything God has made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power, his divine nature. So they have no excuses for not knowing God. And that's true of us and all the world. Awesome can only describe God alone. Who is in heaven as his footstool. And the word says in Revelation 4 that day after day, night after night, these powerful beings around the throne keep on saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the one who always was, who is, and who is still to come. Wow. A holy God. That's why we honor him today. Pure and radiant, without blemish or stain, full of untainted goodness and without fault or blame. God is the embodiment of perfection. He is the one that we worship. Everything, James says, that is good and perfect comes into our life from him. And that goes on to say at the end that there's never a shadow, a chance that he'll ever change. How many of you are holding on to that verse? Okay, we could go on and on about God's greatness. I love it when you're saying our God is a mighty God and we dropped out and it was just the drums. I mean, there's just power in that. But I want to tell you, there's the balance. And here's the amazing thing of it all. Here's the balance. He is universally awesome. But he is personally awesome as well. Aren't you glad about that? I mean, universally, whoa, he made it all. But he's personally awesome that he is individual. He goes one-on-one with all of us. He says, my greatest goal and joy is to have you be the worshiper that I've created you to be and for me to take up residence and live in you and to live my life out through you. That's why we sing songs like, draw me close to you. Psalm 113 says it, who can be compared with the Lord our God who is enthroned, oh, I love this, on high. Okay, that's the universal awesomeness of God. Did you see that? Who can be compared with the Lord of God who is enthroned on high? We love to praise that God, don't we? But don't you love this, verse 6? He stoops to look down on heaven and earth, and that's the personal God. He is not far away. He is near to every one of us. So the word says that we may grope and find our way to him. Wow. Personal. 139 of Psalm verse 3 says, you scrutinize my path and my lying down and are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Is anybody encouraged by that? That's a personally awesome God. You scrutinize my life. That's not bad. That's good. You are intimately acquainted with all my ways. And that's so we don't just worship him here, but it's a part of our life. And all through the week, we're so encouraged because we know that wherever we are, what are we doing? He is intimately acquainted with all of our ways. Wow, what a powerful thought. Thank the Lord for that. He's totally aware of all the details. He knows everything. He knows us completely. We sang Tuesday night at Tuesday night prayer. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. I have a maker. Oh, what a powerful thought. This infinite God who has invited all of us to respond to his great love that we might worship him, that we might engage our free will. He knows that's the best thing that we can possibly do for ourselves. To put him first. To exalt him. For our lives, daily living to flow out of the greatness of who he is. I'm telling you, that's where so many of us are stuck today. Because we're trying to live out of the things we see and understand as opposed to the greatness of who he is. That sets worship on course. The heavens are telling the glory of God, Psalm 19:1 says, and their expanse is declaring the work of his hands. That's what worshipers do. Why? Because God is awesome. He is universally awesome. And secondly, he is personally awesome, and he has come to make himself known and real to every one of us in relationship. We worship God genuinely for who he is. We worship him. And that brings, if you will, a creative tension always between that universal awesome and that personal awesome, the infinite God and the intimate God. I mean, you see what I'm talking about? He is high lit and lifted up, but he is near and dear. Isn't that amazing? He's here and he's near and he's dear. Wow. Romans 8, 15, 16 says that you have not received, and we used that song this morning, this intimacy as his beloved children, knowing we belong to him as sons and daughters. Romans 8 speaks to that. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you have received God's spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba Father. That's why worship of an awesome God can truly be an awesome experience, because it's not about us, it's about him. Got it? For his spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. How much closer could we ever get? We're constantly considering how awesome God is. He stands alone, unequaled and unmeasured. We're to stand in awe of who he is and what he has done. Truly amazing. And at the same time, don't miss it. We must totally embrace him through the provision of his son. We must surrender to and melt into his tender embrace this personally awesome God. You know what I mean? It's like hugging somebody that's as stiff as the bark on a tree and they bow their back away. Or when you hug somebody and they love you and they just melt into your embrace. That's what he longs for us to do. Not to lean away and arch our backs, but to lean in. Got to wrap this up. Worship begins with our response to who good God is. We must be convicted. We must be convinced about that. That sets the stage for gratitude to flow out of us like a river. We will never be truly filled with gratitude until we decide on God's greatness to agree with who he is. And I would say that truly perpetual, ongoing gratitude is one of the things that is hugely missing, because it's so seasonal, it's so situational. But God says, no, stand wherever you are in gratitude to me, my greatness, because I never change. I'm just as great as I was before you got the news, or before this or that or the other. I stand alone in my greatness. And I want to tell you something that happens on this earthly realm when we stand in a given situation and we extol God's greatness regardless of our situation. And we say, Lord, I will praise you and I will thank you, because your word says to come in with thanksgiving and into it with your courts with praise. And that's exactly what my life's about. How that shapes the direction of our life. Oh, this should keep us worshiping for a lifetime. Don't forget along the way to praise him and thank him for the very breath that launches our worship, that gives words, gives rise to our worship and song. If God were to never do another thing for any one of us in this room today, how many could say, yeah, he's done enough. We owe him big time. How many could say, we owe him big time. We owe him our devoted worship, our lavish praise, our thanksgiving. Gratitude's always right because he has given us Jesus, and he'll never take him away. He's given Jesus as a free gift so that we could know him intimately, this personal God. Someone has written that in this personal worship deal, it's like arrows. Our loving worship back to him is like an arrow that pierces the Father's heart. Isn't that good? How many of you think we've launched some arrows here today? I mean, when we launch arrows in worship, they hit the mark every time. They hit the Father's heart. And he says, that's my son. That's my daughter in whom I am very well pleased. Because they're doing what I created them to do. They're being obedient. They're worshiping me. And he especially loves it when we do it on a cold, snowy Sunday in the spring in Ohio. I mean, he loves it when we do that. He loves it when we're at the height of success, and he loves it when we're at the lowest point in our lives. He loves it because he wants our arrows to be pointed and released to him, the Father's heart. Could we do that? Well, all week long I've been listening to my friend that I've never met, Andre Crouch, sing my tribute to God be the glory, great things he has done. It's all about him. It's who he is, but it's also, that song says it so well, it's about who he is, but it's also what he has done through Jesus Christ. That's why we're fixing to celebrate Easter. in this season. So could we stand to our feet as we conclude, and could we go to this? I hope you have Psalm 95, 1 to 7, and I want us to read it out loud, and then I want us to conclude with a song of praise. Don't you just love the atmosphere in here today? I mean, the greatness of God. He just puts it all together. So we go forward focusing on how universally awesome He is, but knowing that He's personally awesome and intimate and real in our hearts and lives. So could we read this? Do you have that Psalm 95, 1 to 7? Okay, we're going to read through 7, I think, if we get there. Here we go, out loud. Come on, I mean, let's read it like we sing it, okay? We're not saying it, we're reading it. Let it flow from the heart. Here we go. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come to Him with thanksgiving. Let us sing psalms of praise to Him. For the Lord is a great God, a King above all gods. He holds in His hands the depths of the earth and the mightiest mountains. To sea belongs to Him, for He made it. His hands formed the dry land too. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For He is our God. We are the people He watches over, the flock under His care. If only you would listen to His voice today. And all the people said, Father, thank You for Your presence in this place today, that You are an awesome God, awesome, universal, everything is under You, but that You are awesomely intimate and personal. Oh, God, give a hunger for anybody in this room that hasn't engaged. They may be agreeing how great You are and a universal sense of Your greatness and awesomeness, but Lord, You want to make it personal. And if there's anybody here that needs to invite You to come in and to forgive their sin and to take care of the sin in their life and set them on a different path, may they take that step today as we extol Your greatness. Let's close with a mighty song of praise. If you want to partake of communion, celebrating God's greatness, who He is, be reminded of what He's done. If you want to come and kneel and pray about anything, if you want to come and get to know Him personally, that awesomeness in a personal life, you can do that. This is His time. We're His people. This is how we'll end today. This is how we'll end. He is great. He is great.
You spread out the sky.
Universal, yes.
Over empty space. And said, let there be light. To a dark and formless world, Your light was born. You spread out Your arms over it. You said there be light. To a dark and hopeless world, Your Son was born.
Your greatness, yes.
You are worthy.